Hello again, and welcome back to another edition of 5 Minutes on K-12 Online Learning With. And today our with is Amy Michalowski. So, Amy, can you start off by telling us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Thanks for having me today. I started out as a high school chemistry teacher, actually, in a suburban district in Massachusetts. Our school was part of the VHS program, which is a supplemental online provider that partners with schools and districts to kind of fill gaps based upon scheduling or budget or staffing needs. And I trained to be a VHS teacher about 2002. And then four or five years later, decided that a switch out of bricks and mortar teaching was going to be right for me and my family. And I've been with VHS since. Started as a curriculum coordinator, which is a kind of department head position overseeing teachers in their courses, and then have moved on up through the ladder to being in the position I'm in now, which is responsible for curriculum and instruction.
All right, very good. So over the years, you've worn a number of different hats as a school leader, and school leaders, once you've sort of done it once, opening up and closing a school year can sort of become a little bit formulaic. But this year we've got a real big disruption that's happened in our school year. So what advice would you have for school leaders on how they can, in terms of the process of closing up this school year and starting up the next one, that can accommodate what's happened during this disruption?
Yeah, you know, that's a great question. And you're absolutely right. I think that our mantra this spring has been flexible and clear communication. So just to make sure that we're connected to our member schools and that we're adapting to needs as they arise. In general, I think that, you know, my advice to school leaders during this really stressful time would be to focus on those things that are important from school leaders every year, but critical this year, which are, you know, really clearly communicating, making sure that you're transparent with your stakeholders, focusing on social emotional wellness and equity, and really just trying to understand the critical components of teaching and learning that have to be done well so that students are ready to progress. You know, as a parent of 4 kids across different grade levels, you know, clarity and consistency from school leadership to understand how students, what they need to do on a regular basis, and then how that is going to be shared with the schools is really important. I recommend, you know, we reach out to our stakeholders once a week just with updates when they're appropriate, and looking ahead to say, this is what's coming up next week, this is what you have to be aware of, here's our plans, things we know and things we don't know. You know, the volume of email and updates can be really overwhelming just for parents. As a parent that has worked in online learning now for, you know, almost 20 years total, I even find myself just, you know, kind of completely underwater sometimes with the number of updates. So, you know, from a leadership perspective, help your teachers find ways to be efficient in their communication with their families. You know, kind of throttle the number of platforms you're focusing on, do departmental or grade level page updates where teachers can post what's required. Be sure that you're clear with families to understand how you find the information you need and where you go if you can't get that. And really keep it simple sometimes. You know, make sure that you have single points of access whenever possible. If you're lucky enough to have instructional technology staff, which I know not every school and district is able to have, really take advantage of them or teacher leaders to identify platforms that allow for efficient use. And then, you know, honestly, social emotional wellness, I think, has got to be the second most important thing for every school leader aside from transparency. And that means more than just student social emotional wellness. I think it's teachers and faculty and staff members too. Focus on connecting with kids and making sure that, you know, they're connected with each other and with a staff member or somebody at the school that knows them and cares about them. I remember I've read so many times about how this is the most connected yet disconnected, you know, generation of kids, right? Because of social media and devices, they have access to people, but they're really, you know, in many cases, superficial connections that, you know, make them feel like they have people that they can touch base with, but they don't. So that can mask a lot of loneliness and feeling of aloneness that, you know, is really going to be something that schools are going to have to handle. And teachers feel that too. So, you know, making sure you pivot into synchronous communications when you can, find ways to set that up equitably within your district, give the teachers the support they need, you know, have teacher groups getting together and things like that. I think it's just really important. And, you know, equity and access, this is where I think school leaders have to dig in and put their creative problem solving hats on and understand what their community's needs are, figure out if there is a way to source, you know, technology is not the answer to everything. Get some help from parents as liaisons, understand what systems you have in place that can support students' needs. Many typical classroom accommodations can be made in an online space fairly easily. So help teachers understand what that looks and feels like in their online classroom space, and then focus your attention and your district leadership's attention on the things that require outside products or synchronous communications or telehealth. And then last, but by no means least, I think priority standards only. So really work, hopefully in your school or district, you have a set of power standards, the things that at your state level you need to have met, but sometimes I think making sure that students are as prepared as they can be for the next academic year is going to be important. And then you have to make it okay for your staff to let a few things go and understand that there can be depth of knowledge and deeper learning gained throughout the course of additional exposure in future academic years.
All right. So thinking beyond just the immediate ending of this school year and beginning of next school year, throughout the 2021 school year, we're likely going to see either local flare-ups that cause some districts to have to close. There may be a second wave that comes through before we get a vaccine available and enough people vaccinated for herd immunity. Mm-hmm. What sort of things can school leaders be thinking about and doing now to essentially allow them to shift to a remote learning situation next year a little more seamlessly than sort of the abrupt fashion that all had to do it this year?
Yeah, somewhere along the way this spring, I've heard the term emergency remote learning coined, and I really like that because I think what has happened in schools and districts this spring has not been, necessarily the same kind of quality online programming that many providers and schools have done for years. It's challenging. I think that school leaders have to remember that they are the calm in the storm. So one thing is don't try not to be worried, right? You have to let your public persona be the calm and voice of reason for your community. And that's students, and that's your local school board or school committee, and that's parents and faculty as well. I think the most important thing a school leader can do is take some time and have really hard and honest conversations with their faculty, reflect on what went well this spring and reflect on what didn't, and be upfront with each other about, you know, what you need to do better if this happens in the fall. Leadership creates space for meaningful conversations about what, didn't go well. And if you don't have a safe area or safe opportunity for faculty to own some of their own challenges personally or academically, then you're just not going to understand the problems that you're trying to solve. So I think that that's the biggest and most important thing. Get some honest feedback from all your stakeholders. Ask parents, ask kids. I hear a lot of districts that are serving families, but they're not necessarily serving students. And I know my high school and college student would be able to tell you what they love and what is not going okay for them right now. I think you have to talk to your teachers, engage with your faculty now, kind of not just team or departmental planning, look at, across grade levels, ask teachers what they need for support and professional development and understand how you can get them access to that. There are skills that are necessary to be developed to be an effective online teacher. And it's okay that a, 20, 25 year or 5 year bricks and mortar teacher that's excellent at their teaching craft doesn't have those skills yet. And I think it's just really important for school leaders to name that and say, you can be the most wonderful face-to-face teacher, and we haven't given you the skills in order to transfer those pieces of your personality and what you do well into the online environment, but we can help you get there. And I think that that just takes a little bit of conversation and some planning. There are lots of opportunities and resources for professional development and professional learning that are out there for teachers and administrators alike. And I think that you have to kind of prioritize what your most important pieces are. And I think that that's going to help kind of ease the burden for some of your teachers, encourage them to take advantage of curricular and content resources that can help them more seamlessly transfer. There are companies and resources available that have content that can be kind of administered by a teacher face to face, and then you're ready if you have to take that online. And sometimes taking some of that lesson planning and content development burden off their plates gives teachers the space to focus on the teaching and the connection with students, which is an assessment, which is really kind of the most important piece. In our program, when we develop courses, it takes a subject matter expert and one of the members of my team, hours and hours and hours and hours to create a semester long class. And I think that when you add that to a teacher that's not typically ready for that mode of learning, or mode of teaching rather, you can start to see where the work burden just becomes untenable. So, take advantage of resources. It might not be anybody's immediate plan, but, there will probably be times in which you may have to pull back. And having that continuity piece is going to be important. And last but not least, I think, is really focus on that equity aspect and try to understand what's happening in your special education community. Understand what your families have experienced. Do what you can in order to provide service and to provide learning materials to students that are accessible to them. And that's just, it's a tough problem. There's no silver bullet out there for equity, especially in areas that have connectivity issues or access issues to devices. So those are things that are going to have to be, well thought out planned ahead.
All right, perfect. Well, thank you very much. So this has been another edition of 5 Minutes on K-12 Online Learning With, and today our with has been Amy Michalowski.
Thanks so much, Michael. Yep, perfect. Thank you.
All right, thank you.